It is never too late to start your self-hosting journey, and it doesn't matter if you're good with computers or not. Everything can be learned, and I speak from experience. Because I used to work in restaurants as a waiter before I became a system administrator for Windows and Linux. Today I will show you a roadmap to kick off your self-hosting journey in 2026. This roadmap has 11 steps and starts with the very basics like Linux and Docker. I made a self-hosting roadmap playlist with videos to every step. The link is in the description and you can also find the playlist in the upper right corner. Step 1. Install Ubuntu server. Use an old computer or use a VM like Hyper-V or VMware. Ubuntu server will be the foundation to all your projects. Don't worry if you mess up your server, you will delete and set up your Linux server many times when you do self-hosting. And with every installation you will get better and better and get more familiar with the command line. And once you learn Docker in step 4, you will realize how easy it is to just take down your server, reinstall everything and deploy your Docker containers again. But let's continue with step 2, learn basic Linux commands. The command line can be scary at first, it's only text, there's no buttons, no pictures, and you don't even know what you should type. The good thing is, you don't need to learn every single command. Learn how to navigate through the file system, how to create new directories, move them, rename them, how to edit and delete files, and how to list files in a directory. Also, write down your commands. Documentation is key in everything in IT. None of us know every single powerful command by heart, but it is helpful to know that it exists for a certain action and to know how to look for it. You will encounter a lot more commands once you start building your own projects. Step 3. Learn Vim and Nano. You will edit configs constantly. Nano is super easy and Vim is powerful. You should know them both. Personally, I enjoy Vim more, but it's really up to your own preference. Just keep in mind that Docker containers have a minimal operating system, meaning that Nano and sometimes even Vim is not available there, if ever you need to directly go into your container. But what you always find there is VI, which Vim is based off. The most important Vim command is how to exit it without saving anything. Just press escape, colon, Q, exclamation point, and then enter. Other than that, just press I to be able to type. With escape, you can get back to the command mode, and here with double D, you can even delete a whole line. With U for undo, you can undo those actions again. You can also just delete a word with DW for delete word, or DB for delete backwards if you want to delete the word behind your cursor or in front of your cursor, however you see it. But again, you don't need to learn everything, just how to open it, to edit it, and then to save it. Step 4 is to learn Docker, finally. Once you feel safe with your commands, it is time to explore and play around with Docker. In a nutshell, on your Linux server, you will start another Linux server on top of it that will provide a database, a website, or something else. And those services can be accessed through certain ports. If you haven't encountered ports yet, those are just doors through which a computer communicates with a server and the other way around. For example, to browse on a website, your computer reaches out to port 443 on a web server. And in Docker, you can configure that container number 1 is accessible through port 3000, and container number 2 is accessible through port 4000. That way you can run many containers on the same server without them interfering each other. That's why Docker is so genius. You don't need to install a bunch of stuff on your Linux server because everything that service needs is already packed inside that container. And if you don't want to run it anymore, you just close the container, you stop it, you delete it, and it is as nothing ever happened on your Linux server. And you best learn and understand Docker when you start playing around with it. Just check out Docker Hub to see what different Docker images are around there and play around with them. And remember, you can't break anything on your Linux server with Docker. Also, try out Portainer. That's a tool that lets you manage your Docker containers in a web UI, which makes it super easy. Step 5 is to build your own Nextcloud and to learn Docker Compose while you're doing it. Once you understand Docker and played around with some containers, it is time to learn Docker Compose. With Docker Compose, you can start up multiple containers at once with a single command. That way, you can build projects that needs multiple containers to work together. A good project for that is Nextcloud. Nextcloud is your private cloud. Files, sharing, calendar, even messaging, all hosted by yourself. By itself, it already needs two containers, a database and a web server. But you can extend that with a Redis container, a high performance backend container for video calls, and even Collabora for file editing in a team. You can find tutorials to follow along in the roadmap playlist and of course on my channel page. If you enjoy my videos and my content, leave a like and consider subscribing. It really helps out small channels like mine. Thank you for your support. Step 6 is how to open ports on your router. With your Nextcloud up and running, you can access it at home. But is a cloud really a cloud if you can only reach it at home? That's a perfect opportunity to learn about ports and how to open them and forward them on your router. Your ISP assigns you a public IP address. When you enter that into a browser, it will lead right up to your router. But most likely nothing will show up because your router isn't providing any service that can respond to a possible request. But your Nextcloud in your home lab is. You can configure a port forward so that every request on port 443 on your router will be forwarded to your Nextcloud in your home lab. That way you can access your Nextcloud from anywhere in the world as long as you have internet. But be careful. Opening ports on your router at home means that you're opening it for anyone on this planet. So security is mandatory. Plus, normally your ISP changes your IP address every 24 hours or so. So you either need a static IP address or a dynamic DNS provider. Step 7 is to learn about domains, DNS, HTTPS, and SSL certificates. That's a lot. A domain is basically a name, like youtube.com or thesysadminhub.com. Then you have subdomains like cloud.thesysadminhub.com or uptime.thesysadminhub.com. With subdomains, you can name many different services and projects because it's easier to remember a URL than a random IP address. And for your browser to know which URL, which subdomain leads to which IP address, you need DNS records. There are many different kinds of DNS records, but in the beginning you only need one, that's the A record that assigns a name to an IP address. At this point you need to think about security again. Everything you make publicly accessible is first reachable through HTTP, which is unencrypted and not secure at all. What you want is HTTPS, and for that you need an SSL certificate. And with a domain and subdomains, you can easily request 100% free certificates from Let's Encrypt. And on Linux server, it is super easy. And you might think I only need my home lab for me at home and I don't need a domain. I don't want to pay for that. But owning a domain comes with a few perks. First of all, you always have the choice to make your project public if you choose to, but furthermore, a domain is a unique name and only you own that. And email addresses also go hand in hand with domain names. Take my domain, thesysadminhub.com, for example. I own that domain and I control it, so I decide where the different subdomains lead to. And also, no one can have an email address with @thesysadminhub.com without me knowing and approving of it. Let's continue with step 8, which is exploring cloud server options. At this point, you have your Nextcloud running on a Linux server with Docker Compose and a port forward on your router to reach it with your subdomain via HTTPS. And that is a really big accomplishment. You can be proud of your work so far. When I was at that point, one thing really kept bugging me. The subdomain is pointing to my home, to my private network. And to be honest, I didn't like that. I don't want my private network to be exposed like that. Plus, if ever my internet goes down, something happens to my server, to my home lab, or the electricity goes out, then my Nextcloud would be offline. So maybe it is time to consider switching to a cloud server provider. And they're not that expensive at all. You can start with a small 2 CPU and 4 gigabytes of RAM server. That's already plenty to run a couple of projects and Docker containers on that. Plus, you don't need to worry about attacks. I mean, there might still be attacks, but it's not on your home network anymore. It's on your virtual private server, your VPS, which is anywhere in the world on a cloud server provider. Additionally, the server uptime and the hardware is monitored and maintained by the cloud provider. So it's really convenient. Personally, everything I have publicly available is on a cloud server. No open ports or Cloudflare tunnels to my home network. Owning a cloud server leads us to step 9, reverse proxy. Theoretically, for every project that you have, you can run a different server. And sometimes that is needed, like my Mailcow mail server is on a completely different dedicated Linux server that only runs this mail server. But on my other server, I run many, many different containers all at the same time. That's where a reverse proxy like Nginx helps. Every subdomain points to the IP address with the reverse proxy on it, and then Nginx will sort it out, and depending on the URL of the request, it will forward the traffic to the correct Docker container. Plus, Nginx handles all the SSL certificates, and CertBot even renews them automatically for me, so I don't need to worry about those. But don't just limit yourself to Nginx. There is also traffic and my newest preferred reverse proxy, SaveLine, because of all the awesome security features. And speaking of security features, step 10 is hardening and security. Server hardening and security is mandatory. You need to take care of it, regardless of running everything in your home lab or on a cloud server. That includes configuring your firewall and only open ports that are really necessary. Sometimes it also makes sense to open ports only for certain IP addresses. You can use fail to ban to block anyone who tries to guess your passwords. Always use secure passwords and different passwords, and two-factor authentication wherever possible. And consider changing your passwords periodically, especially the default passwords. Those are just a few things you can do, but it is a start. Security isn't a one and done thing. It is something that needs to be done over and over again. And the last step of your self-hosting journey in 2026 is more projects. Just keep on building more and more projects. Like a Mailcow mail server. Use an Nginx proxy manager, that's a web UI for Nginx. Use a password manager like Sono. Use a Jellyfin media server. Use paperless. Deploy Uptime Kuma to monitor your different services and projects. Maybe even Home Assistant for a smart home or Image for photo backup. There's so many different projects you can do. So many tutorials here on YouTube, not just from me, but so many other people as well. And each project teaches you something new: networking, database, storage, backup, and monitoring, and many other things. And again, everyone started somewhere, so don't give up just because you don't know anything yet. There's always videos like mine to show you how it is done, and also AI can be a really big help. This roadmap gets you from zero to running production-grade services in 2026. I hope this video helped you. If you watched to the end, let me know in the comments. Thank you all for watching, and see you next time.